King's justice. You have established both equal equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at his footstool, which is holy. Moses and Aaron were among his priests, and Samuel was among those who called on his name. They called upon the Lord, and he answered them. He spoke to them in the cloud and pillar. They kept his testimonies and the ordinance he gave them. You answered them, O Lord our God. You were to them God to forgive. Though you took vengeance on their deeds, exalt the Lord our God and worship at his holy hill, for the Lord God, for the Lord our God is holy. Pray. O God, through the compassion of your only begotten Son, forgive his glory upon the holy mountain. Grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to be our cross and be changed in his likeness from glory to glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Nick.
Okay, we now come to the time in our service where we share our joys, our concerns, or any joys that we share. Okay, Linda?
I just wanted to share with everyone, my son, Father Marvin, that we were praying for, had a visit at New York previously, and they said they're doing a case study, I think it was no one, but something mentioned has survived.
Uh-huh.
And I do hope that we can go on, because it's power spirit, and has gone away, that I was through several times. So I think that's a really good.
Good, wonderful work, that's testimony. Good glory to God for that. Okay, any others? Anybody here happy about the rain? Oh, yeah, I saw some. Thank you, Stephanie. Well, it is what it is. We should have plenty of good flowers. Because think about it a little bit, cold weather down here is very important, and so that things will grow, and the bugs will not thrive. So we're going through this, hopefully we'll have a springtime that will be wonderful. Of course, you'll probably have a lot of KD cases going on, just like that, so that's the way it is. Okay, any other joys to be shared? Okay, Richard?
It's 2 degrees in Kansas City this morning and snowing.
2 degrees, okay. Wow. Kind of makes you glad you're living in South Carolina.
Absolutely.
Oh, boy. Yes, sir. Yeah. Okay, I think a lot of reasons. Thank you for it. Any others? Okay, Stephanie?
It's Valentine's Day.
Oh, okay. Good.
Yeah.
And thank you for this little Valentine gift and things like that. Thank you very much. Okay. Good.
It is so beautiful to look back there and see all those children.
That's right. Amen. Jesus says, supper room children coming in, but they are not such as the kingdom of God. Amen. Okay. Any other joys?
Not everybody.
Okay. Now, we'll move into time when we share our concerns. By now, most everybody knows that Miss Francis Pine has passed away. And so she will be buried up in Baltimore. So we'll be praying for traveling mercies for Ron, Linda, and family. But we all know that she was a wonderful Christian lady. It was an honor to know her. 100 years of life, and but she lived every morning. It was a wonderful honor and testimony. Okay? Any other concerns?
We'll pray for you to be
along. Oh, yeah. My uncle, he did his funeral yesterday. But he was a good man, and we had a wonderful time there with the family in that church in Providence Baptist. My uncle was saved, and we just brought a lot of family in that area, so getting a chance to get back and connect with him and things like that. So sad, but yet, you know, we're, as Christians, we don't spare. And he was a farmer. He was before he rode the farm, thinking that he was special guy. Had a lot of good times. Okay? Thank you for your prayer and support. Any other concerns? And continue to remember the pandemic and all that's going on with that. The vaccine rolls out, and I'm hoping the different variants will be covered, and there's just so many things we're dealing with. Also, our country, the world, there's a lot of heartbreaking things going on out there. And all the more reason for us to stay true to Jesus and be steadfast in our faith and keep our eyes on Jesus Christ. Any other concerns anybody wants to share? Okay, any unspoken requests? All right, we're going to have a call for prayer and we're going to have a word of prayer. hearts full of praise and adoration for you. Give you glory, God. Our whole purpose for being here this morning is to worship you, true God, Jesus Christ. Your God, we thank you for the Holy Spirit that works in our lives and helps us become more like Jesus. Your God, we look to you this morning for hope, for cleansing, for power to live a life. And we're here, dear God, to ask you to come into our church and our service this morning and into our lives and our hearts in a very special way. Dear God, this morning, as we mentioned, this world has got a lot of problems for us, a lot of hurt, a lot of pain out there. Dear God, we know in our hearts that the gospel is true and the world needs Jesus and needs Jesus more than anything else. And what the world really needs is for us Christians to be faithful and not just talk a lot, but walk a lot. If we learned in our Sunday school lesson this morning, we'll gain that we have to take our faith and put it into action so that people can see and touch and know that something different about us, that your Spirit lives in us in a wonderful, powerful, tangible, palpable way, dear God. And dear God, we know that's what changes the world. It changed the world back in the early days of the church and all throughout history. The actions of Christians, dear God, have made a difference. Help us, dear God, to be the church and to help us to win people into your kingdom, dear God. And the people will find the church a place of rest, an oasis in the desert, dear God. It's time to refresh your soul. Dear God, this morning, we pray for those who are hurting, those who have been bereaved. Dear God, we pray for all the folks who have health problems and facing serious challenges. Dear God, we just pray the healing for them, dear God. And Lord, help us to come to that peace that passes all understanding when we put our lives and seasons of our lives completely and totally into your hands, dear Father. Dear Lord, we pray this morning that as we give our offerings, that we will be good stewards of the things that you've given to us, dear God. And we promise that we'll use these gifts to further the gospel of the kingdom of God. Lord, we thank you for the young people in our church and for the young people in our community. And dear God, we realize, especially this past weekend, as I interacted, dear God, with all my nieces and nephews, how important it is, dear God, for them to have role models and to know the faith and to know the truth, because Lord, the faith is so much in this world, dear God. Dear God, help us in our endeavor to win others in Jesus' name. Lord, we pray for the Holy Spirit to be with us in this service in a wonderful way. You open up your word to us, dear God, and speak to our hearts. And now, Lord, we all pray together the prayer that you taught us to pray, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Overseas, for the hurting I say, opening ears across the street.
Now after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by himself, and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. Then Peter answered and said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here, if you wish. Let us make your three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I will please. Hear him." And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and said to them and said, "Arise, and do not be afraid." And they lifted up their eyes, and they saw no one but Jesus only. Now as they came down to the mountain, Jesus commanded them, saying, "Tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man is risen from the dead."
Thank you, Nate. I know today's Valentine's Day. If you want to read a really good example of love and love story, here's some research from Charles Wesley, the writer, Brother John's brother, and his wife, Sally. And it's a beautiful love story. I'm not going to go into it anymore. I'm going to stimulate your curiosity. A good example of a good example of marriage. Of course, I hope we all know that Valentine was a saint who basically he loved to marry people. That's what he wanted to do. In that way, he gave his life because he was forbidden to do that. The Roman Empire didn't want their soldiers to be married because he felt like they did away with their strength or whatever. Kind of crazy idea, but they took this people that clown and whatever about it, and ultimately, he didn't know his life. But what we're talking about this morning is the transfiguration, or change. And I'd like to share another verse of scripture with you to go along with the ones that were read by Nate this morning. 2 Epistle of Peter, verses 16 through 21. He says, "Well, we did not follow the cunningly devised fables which we made known to you, the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received from God the Father honor and glory when such a voice came to him from his excellent glory. This is my beloved Son, whom I'm well pleased. And we heard this voice which came from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. And so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed as a light that shines in the dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any interpretation. For prophecy never came by the will of man, but only the holy men of God spoke as they were moved by the Holy Spirit." So, we have here several verses of Scripture where we have the theme of being the Lordship of Jesus Christ, or the glory and power of God, to help us. Everything that we've read this morning to help us understand how majestic and wonderful God is, Jesus is, Jesus the Son, and that it goes through the Old Testament, and even here in the New Testament, it's Jesus and his disciples who went to go with and saw him transfigured. And the simple fact is that it's very important that we understand who God is, and see his glory, and understand that he also wants to transfigure and change us. He wants to change. He saves you where you're at. He accepts you as you are. If you truly come to him in repentance. But he wants to change you. He doesn't want you to stay there. He wants you to grow. And in order to help us understand this, the Bible quite often uses opposite things to help us come to an understanding of what wholeness is. Let me ask you this. How many here have ever had a potato candy bar? Hey. What do you like best? The salt? The peanuts? Or the pomegranate? You take away the peanuts to eat the candy? Okay. Well, no. The whole thing, right? It's better. Okay? Really, if you wanted to like it, okay? And that's important. That's the way the Bible is. It's the way we get it. One way to help us understand what God is trying to do. And things like that, for example, words, quite often words that sound the same can have a different meaning, and it's important to understand that in order to kind of get along in this world. For example, I was riding down the road driving one time, and I had somebody sitting on the right hand side, passenger side, and I said, at the stop sign, do you take a left? And the person said, right. Well, guess what? I got in the right hand lane. And they're right. And then take another route and turn around and go back. Okay? So, it's important to understand those kind of things. And another thing is that, for example, we all know that communication is important and that talking is important. Okay? But we also know that in communication, silence is important. Sometimes you should listen. And I've often thought some of the best examples of communication is when a couple can be together and not say anything and still know what somebody else is thinking. Okay? So that's important. So we need to understand that in life, our ministry and how we help others is a strength. Okay? To be able to help others is a strength. But it's also a strength to be able to allow yourself to be helped. To realize you need help and to ask for help. I know that I've had times when I've gone in to pray with people, minister to people, and then that I have had them out of the terrible situation, difficult situation they were in, minister to me. And I needed to, hey, I realized that, hey, it was good for me to let them do that. Okay? So God uses these kind of different things to make us whole, put flavor in our life, and texture in our life. And so what we have here is in our Christian walk, when we feel weak and broken, it's in that very brokenness we need to find our strength in Christ. Jesus tells us that in order to find Him, we must deny ourselves. To gain life, we need to take up the symbol of death of the cross. We need to deny ourselves, take up the cross and follow Him in order to live, we must die to self. Okay? Different things, but yet bring them together, look at it in context, and you have a life. Okay? That's important. That's the thing about Christianity. So it requires the people to understand the world that in order to truly live, we must lose our life. We have to give our life up to Him in order to find life. So we have this here situation here where and I think it's worth going over again, chapter 17 of Matthew. Now after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. Then Peter answered and said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here 3 tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. And while he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved Son, and who I am well pleased. Hear him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and touched them and said, arise, and do not be afraid. And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. Now, as they came down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, saying, tell the vision to no one, but the Son of Man is risen from the dead. Yes, these disciples, they wanted to build the tabernacle and stay there. And you can't do that. You go up on that mountaintop, close to God, and inform the experience. But it gets comfortable, but Jesus knows that quite often that can be too comfortable. And we need to get out of that comfort and come down to the mountain and go out pointing to God. So they too can experience. they do. You go on and on and on. So, what does it mean? What does the vision mean for us? It means that we more clearly that our home is found in Jesus, not in our own efforts. Paul says in Romans, be transformed by the renewing of your hearts and your mind. This vision is meant to change you. That song about the Republic, who was transfigured for unity. Okay, I mean, Jesus was transfigured, and they experienced this so that we could really truly understand who he is, what he is, and he is the Son of the living God. That's very, very powerful. So it is glory, and it shows that we are not saved by the law, but we are saved and transformed by Jesus. The law is there as a marker and a guidepost, and it's helpful to know the law, and it's also helpful to as Christians try to fulfill the law. But we need to understand that the law also breaks us. I feel like that, you know, the law of God, the moral law of God, is a lot like the, you ever seen a picture of the Oregon, Seacoast Oregon, where you have these cliffs, and then you see the sea smashing against those cliffs. Well, that's, those cliffs are the moral law of God. And the sea is the masses of humanity. I mean, we're just broken by the law. I mean, we cannot ever be completely, we're just sinners. And that's the way that it is. Now, the only problem with that analogy is that eventually there's a road over time. But with God's moral law, there is a road when we get there. But because Jesus came, and because he was nailed to the cross, and all those sins that are given in the law and the Ten Commandments were nailed to that cross for us, for our sake, if we looked at him, and we also looked at his resurrection, then we are saved. The way we're made whole. And so the transfiguration shows us that death has no power. It had no power over Jesus. It has no power over us. It has no power over Moses and Elijah and all the other people who followed God and listened to God and answered to God and had faith in God, even in the Old Testament times. And that's good news. That we can live our lives in the power of the resurrection, knowing what Jesus has done, the perfect sinless time of God. So, what does that do for all of us? How does it help me not? Well, I know how it helps me is I don't have to be, and we don't have to beat up on ourselves when we have negative emotions or habits that we stumble and fall. Okay? The simple fact of the matter is even if you follow God, you're going to make mistakes, you're going to do things that are not right, and we all do. But God's amazing grace and his transformative power, we can still be whole. We can always look to him. So the fact is that we have to recognize our brokenness. Even after we're saved, we still are fallen human beings. I heard somebody say on the radio the other day, I say a lot of times, we're not sinless, but we sin less. We grow. Okay? And we look to God, we look to Jesus, and we also desire Christmas and fellowship with one another so that we can encourage and exhort and maybe scold one another every now and then. Okay? And so it helps us overcome our mistakes. Because we understand we're not perfect. And also we come to understand that our life is hidden in Christ with God. You know, I got thinking about that a little bit. And there's a wonderful book called The Christian Secret of a Happy Life, written by Hannah Whitehall Smith, who comes back up with a Sunday school, in which she's a lady with a Quaker background, and a wonderful book. It's a very well-read book, and it's a very important book, even in the day of Christianity. And I'm talking about a higher life and a holy life. And it has a lot of good insights in there about how to help those live a life in peace with God. So this blessed, wonderful lady had a wonderful Christian husband, who actually went out on her and committed adultery, and you know, that hurt. I don't know, but yet she was able to still continue on and actually lead him back into the faith. Okay? And so, the simple fact is no matter how good we are, and we do it with this because God makes us good, and how holy we are and come, there's still things that are going to come our way and happen to us that's going to hurt. Okay? And you have to learn to live your life with God. Okay? And then, because of this, if we should be quick to comfort and encourage each other when we see them broken and hurt. Many, many times I've had people tell me that what they went through helped them understand what other people were going through too. And learn to see Jesus the way Jesus sees us. True transfiguration, true change comes about as we begin to reach out to others and be healed and be wounded here, understanding that we all have faults, nobody is perfect, and no situation in this life and in this fallen world is perfect, but our God is perfect. We need to see Him for who He is and the way He is and what His purposes are in this world. The world is a mess. Most of us will have to admit that our lives are a mess. We've all got stuff. But God is here to help us in them. And that's wonderful. And gives us purpose. And gives us meaning. And gives us hope. And so Jesus was the fulfillment of all the prophecies. And everything that He said and did. There was a reason why He was here. He's the Son of God. God sent Him into this world. And we will understand as we go through the Lenten season all about, hopefully more in a different way this year, to go through the church year, about His suffering and what it means to follow Him and deny ourselves and take up our cross and follow Him. And we will grow. Just like to mention something else this morning, I think I've said it before. But you know, we have stained glass windows in the church. But stained glass windows have an interesting history. But basically, back in medieval times, they took broken, shattered glass and pieced it together and colored it so it would let the light that comes through create an atmosphere of holiness within the sanctuary. Okay? And so broken lives, broken glass, stained glass, wholeness, and understanding the light of God. And special transformation today. So this morning, I urge you to be transformed. Open yourself up to God and submit to His will and what He has to say to you. And open yourself up to looking at other people and just kind of moving along beside them and helping them carry their cross. They'll help you carry your cross and minister to you. Each other to minister to one another. That's the way we will make it through this year. That's the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Okay, we will now have the affirmation of our Christian faith. Please stand for Apostle's Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sat at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. revival. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for his transfiguration, and thank you, dear God, for changing me and everything else. God, help us to surrender everything to you, including totally to submissive to your good, holy will. We'll become better men, women, and Christians, and in doing that, we want more people to be the kingdom of God. Thank you for your holiness, your goodness, your mercy, your power, and your justice. Dear God, be with us and pray as we go out into this world to win the world for Jesus Christ in this kingdom. We ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.